Today marks 1 year since former Cuban dictator Fidel Castro died after having ruled his island nation for nearly 50 years. Now a new documentary available on Netflix chronicles the lives of three families during that period of history. It's called Cuba and the Cameraman, and NewsHour Weekend's Christopher Booker recently spoke to the director, Jon Alpert. This segment is part of NewsHour Weekend's ongoing series of conversations with documentary filmmakers.
Jon Alpert's first trip to Cuba in 1974 was a quick one. Defying the American embargo, he and a friend sailed into the country illegally, where they were briefly detained. Their trip ended hours later after a rushed, chaperone drive through Havana by Cuban authorities.
They showed up with these two gorgeous Cadillac convertibles with the big fins and stuff like that, took us on a three-hour trip around Havana and said, okay, you've seen Cuba, time to go home, and kicked us out.
If the Cuban authorities had hoped to diminish Alpert's interest in their country, it didn't work. The 24-year-old New York City filmmaker, intrigued by the communist revolution, was only just getting started.
I want free, good health care for everybody in the United States. I really want it. I want free, good schools for everybody in the United States. I want decent housing. I want equal opportunity. And they were going for it down there in Cuba. So I sure wanted to see for myself.
For the next 45 years, Alpert made regular trips to the island just south of Florida, focusing on three families as they grew and struggled along with the Cuban experiment. Now, for the first time, he's assembled his hundreds of hours of footage into a single film, Cuba and the Cameraman.
As you filmed through the 70s, was there a moment where you said, I'm just going to stick with this story before I actually start cutting something, before I start making a film out of this?
Well, I would like to be able to tell you that I was smart enough and perceptive enough and artistic enough to know that this was the film that we were going to be making, but I wasn't. It was in the second decade that I realized that I wanted to tell the story by following people over a long period of time, because time is a very, very important character in this movie. We meet my friends, we meet Fidel, but tick, 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 the revolution over time and these people's lives over time, maybe it's the most important element.
But as Alpert shows, their stories, like the story of Cuba, can't escape the realities of the Cold War. Cuba made its way through the U.S. embargo with its dependence on sugar exports and subsidies from the Russians, only to see food shortages and empty shelves after the 1991 collapse of the Soviet Union.
You know, if this film would have stopped in 1977, we'd all be headed down to Cuba right now based on where the revolution was at that particular point. But the United States says, you know, we know how to fix this. And we dumped our sugar reserves on the open market. We crashed the sugar price. That like shot two tires out from the revolution. The Cubans, the way they were managing the country, we shot a tire themselves. And when the Soviet Union collapsed, this was a car that wasn't getting any place anymore economically.
Fidel, I broke the blockade. I brought you the best beer in the United States.
Interwoven into the film are Alpert's efforts to follow the revolution's enigmatic leader, Fidel Castro. The film shows Alpert's early interactions with Castro in the 1970s and a final meeting just before he died last year.
How do you describe your feelings for Fidel Castro?
He's in a tippy-top group of people, certainly in our lifetimes, who have had an extraordinary impact on the world. They absolutely impacted every single Cuban, whether people in their own personal cases feel it's for good or for bad.
While Castro worked to expand access to education and medical care in Cuba, he was a dictator who denied his country political freedom, a free press, and jailed his political enemies.
How do you think about or even reconcile some of the realities of the revolution and some of the realities of the Castro regimes?
I'm not trying to reconcile anything. I'm basically trying to help the viewer understand what's been going on in Cuba for the past 50 years. I'm not there to make excuses. I'm not there to misrepresent anything. I'm there to present to you what's been going on in front of my camera, what's happened in the lives of my people, and to allow you to make up your own conclusions.
45 years of footage captures the long, slow, and diminishing promise of the revolution, while his characters offer a window into the resilience of the Cuban people. The young girl who hoped to become a nurse leaves for the United States to work as a janitor. The street hustler spends time in jail for selling items on the black market. The peasant brothers working 5 years to replace a prized ox stolen during the food shortages of the 1990s.
As much as I love Cuba, I'm also sad because I would have liked for everything to have succeeded down there, and it didn't.
And what of that romanticism that first drew you to Cuba and drew you to look at the revolution the way you have?
So my naivete was blown out. I realized in my first week in Cuba that not everybody in Cuba is thinking about the other person, not everybody's altruistic, that you got selfish SOBs in Cuba just like you have here in New York City. We all don't have to do great things, but we should all try to do something to make the world a better place than the world we came into. And this looks at that quest over 45 years in Cuba and tries to evaluate the attempts of people to make the world a better place.
What change do you see in yourself as you watch these tapes and then as you watch this cohesive narrative?
I wish that I was the young, energetic, vibrant person that started this film, but nobody lives a life like that. And you hope that you, for whatever you lose over those years, that what's nice about filmmaking is that you haven't really lost it, because we get to put all those little moments in a bottle, and at the end of 45 years, we got a bottle of wine that's been aging for 45 years that I get to offer to you. I've been giving birth to this film for 45 years, and I'm really happy that it's out. I'm proud of my little baby. Took a long time.